Yes, I'm happy to be here the second time in the United States. I think the last time has been 10 years ago. My English is not as perfect as yours, but I think you will understand me. So I wrote my speech down. The exhibition John told you from is called The White Rose, Faces of a Friendship. Because we think we have been a group, small group of 15 students. We think that this theme of friendship is very, very important for this resistance they made. And now I will tell you how this exhibition was born. And you see just the first photo. It's a very important man. It's Franz. And I show him to you because he always encouraged us to go on with this wonderful story. It was as well a very stressing story because everybody of us worked and studied. And some of us were from Munich, some from Freiburg in Germany. So it's a distance of 4 or 5 hours in train. And it was a wonderful story. And this exhibition was made in 1.5 years. So it was a long time to read and to write and to talk about the texts and to abbreviate and such things you can imagine. So now just a short introduction about the White Rose and the persons. The Weiße Rose, the White Rose, was a group of friends consisting of 5 students and a professor from the University of Munich. From the summer of 1942 until the spring of 1943, they wrote 6 pamphlets criticizing Hitler's criminal regime. The students and some of their friends distributed these pamphlets in several German cities and the University of Munich as well. There, the siblings, Hans and Sophie Scholl, were caught red-handed and placed under arrest. A little later, the rest of the group was caught, and all were sentenced to death by guillotine. How was the exhibition created? A group of students from Freiburg organized a reading of the letters of Sophie and Hans Scholl in a parish in Freiburg on the occasion of the 60th anniversary of the execution of Hans and Sophie Scholl. That was in February of 2003. We were fascinated by the letters and the testimonies of their lives and of these students, by their humanity and their tireless search for truth and beauty. We wanted to know more. Who were the other members of the White Rose? Who were their families? And why could they live so happily under such difficult conditions? We looked for further literature and for the people who had been close friends with the members of the White Rose. As we discovered, these friends and contemporary witnesses are between 80 and 85 years old. It was clear that we were part of the last generation who could get to know them personally. This is one of the last living persons here. It's the sister of Willy Graf, one of the students of the White Rose. She is now 85 years. And she is traveling with me all over through Germany and makes speeches. She's a very impressive woman, you see her, and never tired. And it's incredible how she tells the story about her brother and about the White Rose. Her brother has been the only one who is really educated as a Catholic in his youth. The others then, day by day, went deeper into their faith that I will explain to you later. Then there is another, it's the eldest sister of Hans and Sophie Scholl, Elisabeth Scholl. She's living in Stuttgart in Germany. And as well, she has given us many photos and has told us many things about the siblings Hans and Sophie. Interesting conversations and encounters followed. And the plan to create an exhibition to tell the White Rose story began to take shape. What fascinated us was the story of people involved in resisting Hitler. That it resonates with others as well has been made apparent by the exhibition's unexpected success. I must admit that the exhibition is not just traveling in Germany, but as well in Italy. I've been last year really traveling from the north to the south of Italy. I've been to Sicily as well, in Catania, to tell the story, and we had a real great success as well in Italy with this exhibition. There you see the Italian version. The testimony of a student from Vienna speaks volumes. After seeing the exhibition, he said, "In the white rose, I have discovered my personal desires in compact form and in full extensions. These people lived. They lived with an incredible intensity, and that in a time of dictatorship, in war, and in terrible times." This is a pamphlet. It's the second one. It's a facsimile. It is just made like this in the original. And I just want to read you a short statement from one of these pamphlets. "What is the German people doing? It will not see and will not hear. Blindly, it follows its seducers into its own ruin. Victory at any price is inscribed on their banner. I will fight to the last man, says Hitler. But in the meantime, the war has already been lost. Germans, are we to be a nation which is hated and rejected by all mankind forever? No. Therefore, dissociate yourselves from National Socialist subhumanism. Prove by your deeds that you think otherwise. A new war of liberation is about to begin. The better part of the nation will fight on our side. Tear up the cloak of indifference you have wrapped around your hearts. Make your decision before it is too late." End of quote. Now I will show a short introduction of the group. Here we see Hans Scholl. He is 25 years old. He draws up the first four pamphlets together with his friend Alexander Schmorell. As a student of medicine, he had to join the second student company of the Army Medical Squadron in Munich. 3 months of study and 3 months of practical training on the front. Because of his intelligence and charismatic personality, he is the head of the group. Willy Graf, 25 years old, also a student of medicine, meets Hans and Alexander in the second student company as well. They soon realize that he too opposes the Nazi regime, and they tell him about the pamphlet campaigns which have already taken place. Willy is now faced with the decision of whether to join the White Rose resistance or remain faithful to his old friends. His friends are active in the Catholic youth movement and don't think much of an active resistance. He has difficulty deciding whom he should follow. Eventually, he joins the White Rose. I think they changed some photos. Now should come. Yeah, okay, we make it like this. Alexander Schmorell, 25 years old. He gets to know Hans Scholl in the second student company. He's a medical student as well. Born in Russia, he moves to Munich at the age of 3. And is educated in the Russian Orthodox faith. The sensitive and high-gifted artist his father had a studio established for him always pines for his home country. Sophie Scholl, 21 years old, is the only woman of the group and does not follow Hans to Munich until 1942. There she studies biology and philosophy. She is very fond of nature and left behind detailed diary entries in which she documented her struggle for the pursuit of God and the meaning of life. She happens to discover her brother's activities as the author of the pamphlets. She insists on helping with the campaigns. Christoph Probst, 23 years old. Yet another student of medicine got to know Alexander Schmorell in school at the age of 16. He is the only one among the students who is married. He has 3 little children. Thus, he is kept out of dangerous campaigns as much as possible. However, the outline for a seventh pamphlet that Hans had asked him to write was his downfall. Hans had this outline in his pocket when he was arrested. Christoph was then captured afterwards. Kurt Huber, 49 years old, a professor of philosophy at the University of Munich, who was known for his lectures containing comments critical of the National Socialist government. He knows Hans and Alexander through literary evenings. At first, he had no idea of what the students were up to. However, after the defeat at Stalingrad, he decides to become the author of the sixth pamphlet. So, what made the White Rose members take action, even as they were very familiar with the risks involved? A passion for life, for the beauty of nature, for literature and for music ties them together. They find that holding a mutual opinion about something allows them to grow as individuals and as friends. Sophie writes to her friend, "Hans went off to Russia last week with all the other people. I've made friends with over the past few weeks and months. I still preserve such a vivid recollection of every little farewell word and gesture. I'd never have believed I could become so attached to them all, especially Hans." The friends meet as soon as they can to read books together. For example, Paul Claudel, Saint-Exupéry, Dostoevsky, Kierkegaard, and so on, and to discuss them afterwards. Books are the wood one survives on in the sea. Together, they go to classical concerts and go skiing and hiking in the mountains. Not even the negative aspects of life or unlucky occurrences can spoil their view that reality is essentially positive. At the age of 16, Christoph writes the following lines to his sister, 1 month after their father committed suicide in a psychiatric clinic, where we see his father behind the piano. Christoph writes, "It is as beautiful as ever here. Even the rain could not take the sparkle of beautiful life. Sparkle? When you look into details, into the particulars of daily routine, you are likely to find something else entirely. And yet, there is something like a sparkle on the life of all humans. They only can't sense it, except sometimes in memory. Often it seems lost, but it only seems to be so. Without it, life would be impossible entirely." Shortly after the outbreak of war, Sophie writes to her fiancé, Fritz, we see him over there, "There are 2 roses on my bedside table. Strings of tiny beads have formed on the stems and the leaves which hang down into the water. What a pure and beautiful sight, and what chill indifference it conveys, to think that it exists. That trees simply go on growing, and grain and flowers, and that hydrogen and oxygen have combined to form such wonderful, tepid summer raindrops. There are times when this comes home to me with such force that I'm absolutely filled with it and have no room left for a single thought. All exists, although human beings behave so inhumanly, not to say bestially, in the midst of creation. That's a great blessing in itself." Sophie was often tempted to disappear into a dream world, but she understands that this cannot be an option. Her respect for human beings forces her not to make compromises, quote, "because God descended for man's sake," end of quote. In the winter of 1941-42, she's determined not to help when the German population is called upon to collect woolens for soldiers at the Eastern Front. "We won't give. Whether at this moment it's German soldiers who freeze to death or Russians make no difference. It's all equally bad. We have to lose the war. If we donate woolens now, we help prolong it. It is impressive to follow the individual path of faith that each of the friends followed. At the end of their short lives, Christ was neither an idea nor a theory, but a true companion. The cheerfulness that Alexander expresses in a letter to his sister Natasha after his plea for clemency was declined testifies to the letter. Here we see the group together. My dear beloved Natasha, you may be surprised to hear that with every day I become calmer inside, happy and cheerful even, that for most of the time my mood is better than it was when I was still free. How did that happen? Let me tell you now. All this hard misfortune was necessary to get me on the right path. After all, what did I know of faith, of true, deep faith, or of truth, of the final and only truth, of God? So little. This is Christoph. Hans and Sophie were raised as Protestants. However, the meeting with the Catholic journalist Karl Muth, we see him over there, changed Hans' attitude towards his own life and the world. He writes the following in a letter to his girlfriend. This is Hans. My loneliness was aggravated by two profound experiences of which I must tell you sometime. And last but not least, by this terrible war, this Moloch that insinuated itself into the souls of men and strove to kill them. Then, one day, from somewhere or other, came the answer. I heard and perceived the name of the Lord. My first meeting with you coincided with that period. Thereafter, it grew lighter every day, as if scales were falling from my eyes. I am praying. I feel I have a firm background and a clear goal. This year, Christ has been born for me anew. Willy Graf was executed at the last of the group on 6 October of 1943. In several interrogations, his captors tried to obtain more detailed information about further accomplices of the White Rose. Willy, however, remained steadfast in order to protect his friends. 1 month before his execution, he writes, "Shouldn't we almost be glad that we can take upon us a cross in this world that sometimes seems to go beyond what's humanly possible? In a way, it means to literally follow Christ. Let us try to not only bear this cross, but to love and try to live more fully and have faith in God's will. Then the whole meaning will be fulfilled through this painful suffering. Death is not the end for us, but a gateway, the door to true life. I am trying to become fully conscious of this truth, and I pray for strength and God's blessing. Then the daily things do not affect you as strongly, however they may appear. Fulfillment in life is not in them. But my love for Germany grows day by day, and I have a painful share in its fate and its great wounds." Now we want to hear a short piece of music from Schubert, the Trout Quintet. I just wanted to hear it to you because Sophie loved this piece very much. And she wrote a letter to her brother where she said that she would like to be herself a trout. And she wrote this in February of 43, and it was the same month when they were captured. And she is waiting for the spring, and so she liked this music very much. These short personal impressions can help us to understand what kind of personalities we are confronted with. I would like to take up the topic of education in order to understand better where the courage for resistance came from. The idea of freedom with which some of the friends had been educated by their families allowed a sensitivity to grow that uncovered the falsehood of Hitler's promises. Just as the Scholz father befriended his children through his humanistic and political opinions, so were people like Professor Karl Muth and the architect Manfred Eickemeyer able to make an impression on the young people. The philosophical, theological colloquiums they participated in left a mark on the mindset of Hans, Christel, Willy and Sophie. Education is clearly one of the factors that influenced their way of thinking and acting. There we see the family of Willy Graf. To the right, we see the young sister, which I showed you at the beginning, was now 85 years old. Now should be the family of Scholl, but it's a sort of... No, maybe it comes later, so I read. Let's take a look at two examples. There she is, the Scholl family, from the Scholl family. The father quoted from the poem Beherzigung by Goethe in front of the mirror every morning, often being smiled at by his children. Stand firm against all the powers that be. Never yield, be strong. Summon the arms of the gods to your aid. Hans wrote the sentence, stand firm against all the powers that be, on the wall of his cell before his execution. Another story from the Scholl family shows us that their father had the ability to introduce his children to reality, but without fear. To the left the father, to the right the mother Scholl. The older sister Inge reports what her father imparted to his children when they asked, Father, what is a concentration camp? He told us what he knew and suspected and added, that is war. War in the midst of peace and within our own people. War against the defenseless individual. War against human happiness and the freedom of its children. It is a frightful crime. This talk between father and ourselves occurred on a long hike in the spring. Once again, we had sorrowfully talked out our questions and doubts. What I want most of all is that you live in uprightness and freedom of spirit, no matter how difficult that proves to be, he had added. Suddenly, we were comrades, our father and ourselves, and none of us were conscious that he was so much older. We had the welcome sensation of seeing our horizons widen, and at the same time we understood that this expansion of the world brought with it risk and danger. Regarding education and culture, Don Giussani, the founder of the movement Communion and Liberation, said the following. The human being only creates culture if it interacts with reality. We have to explain to young people how the suggestions we offer them are dealing with them and their specific experience. This point is crucial because culture is a way of living, not of thinking. End of quote. Culture is a way of living, not of thinking. In my opinion, this is the essential reason why the Friends of the White Rose had the power to resist. We cannot track any theories, but this way of living is easy to read about in the accounts left to us by the White Rose members. The effects of this education shifted step by step from the family towards the circle of friends. The students realized that it was difficult to stand alone. In the end, the friends were the ones who prompted each other to follow the truth and an ideal. Thus, the White Rose was not an organization of people who gathered for resistance against Hitler. In fact, they were connected by a close friendship. However, every one of them had to personally say yes to it. The daily conditions under which this yes had to be spoken were far from easy. Reprisals and unspoken threats against dissenters were nothing unusual in Nazi Germany. There we see the book burning. The students resisted the temptation to become cynical, unmotivated, or even lonely and desperate. For many young Germans suffered from loneliness and despair back then, as the German historian Sebastian Hafner points out. He shows the state of isolation in his astute analysis, Defying Hitler, a Memoir, in masterly fashion. Hafner mentions three kinds of temptation which could already exist for a German who was not associated with the Nazi regime in the summer of 1933. He describes the third temptation which he has to deal with himself as the following. You don't want to let yourself be morally corrupted by hate and suffering. You want to remain good-natured, peaceful, likable, and nice. But how to avoid hate and suffering if you are bombarded daily with things that cause them? You must ignore everything, look away, block your ears, seal yourself off. That leads to a hardening through softness, and finally also to a form of madness, the loss of reality. End of quotation. This temptation to lose touch with reality is certainly not relevant only to 1933. That's why the answers that the Friends of the White Rose came up with are surprising to us all. And even more so because each of these friends' characters was so different. And yet they all came to the same solution for themselves by remaining faithful to the questions they carried in their hearts, to give meaning to their desire for truth, beauty, and justice, to reality, to history, to their life and their death. I would like to quote from Alexander one more time. His defense attorney reports, I visited Alexander Schmorell in the afternoon on the day of his death, 13th July of 1943, to accompany him on his last journey. When I came to death row, I met a person who had just received the final comforts of his religion and who had already placed anything worldly far beyond him. I will never forget the words which he spoke almost cheerfully. You will be surprised to find me so calm in this hour, but I can tell you that even if at this very moment they brought the news that somebody else should die in my stead, such as the officer here who must look after me, I would still choose death. Because I am now convinced that my life, however short it may have been, must end in this hour, since through my action I have fulfilled my purpose in life. I wouldn't know what else there would be for me to do, even if I was to be released now. None of this should leave us subdued or despondent. Consider the title of the article on the actress Julia Jentsch, who plays Sophie Scholl in the movie Sophie Scholl, The Final Days. The article is called The Burden of Human Greatness. What a profound concept. Perhaps we will find that to involve ourselves with the White Rose will help us to put the concept of human greatness in a light in which we can see it better, as an experience which is possible for all of us. Thank you.